Now, Bustanai. Bustanai was a Rosh Galuta. Rosh Galuta was a position. It was called in other languages. It's called Exilach. She was the Rosh Galuta was had a official appointment as the head of the Jews in the realm that was Mesopotamia and sometimes many other countries around it. So he was the political chief of the Jews and representing them in a way to the government, but also she was considered as a prince. They were real Jewish princes. See, this was a real prince, because among other things, because they are those exilars are one long dynasty. It's not all. It's cut and jumps from one person to another. But basically, it's a dynasty of people, and all of them are direct descendants from the last surviving king of the descendants of David. So the real princes were called, for us, they were the real royal princes. See, they were kings they were princes of the house of David. All of them. See, and this was they gave him a position for the Jews, and not only for the Jews, as princes. They are not simple people. They are not people that were chosen by whoever it was, but they were people that were they had their own greatness that was embedded in their genealogy, in their lineage. So this was a lineage that everybody could had somehow respect for, more or less, but everybody had respect for. So Bustanai was Rosh Hagola. Rosh Hagola, this was the Jewish title for the head of the exile. But the exile mostly on the land northern to Eretz Israel, and they were considered also among Jews. They were political leaders as political leaders. Now, who were they as people? They were different people. Some of them were considered a great tzaddikim, and some of them were far from it. See, some of them were important in creating things, and some of them were just sitting on what I call it great grandeur. They were grand lords, among other things. They were mostly living. And we'll come to it, because this is an important time. When they lived under the government of the Persians, which was, to be exact, they were first the first Mesopotamia and Iran were ruled first by different dynasty and different possible different nation of Parthians, with a TH. So the Parthians were one dynasty, then came a more Iranian, Persian dynasty, the Achaemenids, that were later on. But, and for them, we have it from some sources, they were considered in the government, in the Persian government, the position was, they were the fourth rank in the government. And there was, the king, the Shah, whatever it was called, but and the Rosh Hagola was number four in the hierarchy. So they were for the authorities, they were great princes. See? And they had the position, and they were what they called, they were friendly or not friendly, but anyway, they were always they had to do with the kings of the realm. Because they were not very rarely in other places we had Jews that had such a position. But they had the hereditary position of rulers of the Jewish people. Now the Jews, because they were the descendants of David, held them in great respect. And in the time when they are referred to, when they are mentioned usually they are mentioned always with the title Mar. Mar, which is master so-and-so, or Maran, or Marana. So this was the title. They were not, some of them could and have been rabbis in that time, but basically this was the title, and the title was a master. They were the masters of the Jews, and they had also officially, from the government, they had the power to execute justice over the Jews. So the Jews in the realm were really under them. And so this was one part. Let me just add, almost as a beginning for the next. Later on, we had a kind of a double government. There were the two great yeshivot of Babylonia, Sura and Pumbedita. The heads of those yeshivot, as were called later Geonim, had also a very high position. And usually the Geonim and Rosh HaGolah, they were the rulers of the Jewry there. So in a very clear way, the relationships between them were not always the same. I mean, sometimes the Geonim were much more powerful because of personality, and sometimes the Rosh HaGolah was a much more powerful person, and the Rosh Yeshiva is an unknown person. It was a Rosh Yeshiva, but basically it was a three-part government. Two Geonim and Rosh HaGolah, they were the rulers of Judaism. I'm mentioning it among other things because this is, in most times, when we had any kind of a Jewish, there was a Jewish autonomy practically up to the time of emancipation. There was some Jewish autonomy. And Jews had a right of a certain amount of self-rule, which depended very much on the politics, on the period, on the religion of the rulers. But basically, it was there. But it was never something that was completely official. In Babylonia at that time, see, the Rosh HaGolah was officially the head of the Jews. It wasn't just a title, an empty title. It was a real title with real power. Possibly the Rosh HaGolah not only could execute justice, he or all the people under him, but seemingly they had the power for dealing with the culprits, by punishing them in different ways, including perhaps a capital punishment. So they were really powerful princes, and they could, and they did from time to time use it. They seemingly, from time to time, it was done later on in other places, the people that were offenders in one way or another sometimes had been ordered to cut their heads. So it's not a nice Jewish way, but they did it. See? There were people that the Rosh HaGolah ordered to cut his head or to kill him. So that is, it's a government. Now, I'm speaking now about Pustanaya, not just because he's a matter, he's a person that was in himself a legend, but also because he lived in a most interesting time. We know more or less, we don't know exactly dates, surely not about his birth, but it's about something like 620 to about 680. That's about the period, since 7th century, which was, politically speaking, a very important point in history. This was the time when the Arabs began to conquer the Eastern world. So it was, Pustanai was the person who was really in the change of governments, from the Persian government to the Arab government. And that is, it is a very important, because of that itself, it is important to remember him, because you see, you have an upheaval. The whole world is changing. The religion of the world is changing. The rulers of the world are changing. See, instead of those traditional rulers that were in many countries, say, in in Palestine, in Egypt, in the later on, about the same time in North Africa, but also in Iraq, Syria, Iran. Those people, it would be an interesting speculation, but I'm not going into it. How could they manage? There was basically not such a big, great people, but how did they manage to conquer a world and create an empire that was as great as some of the greatest empires in the history of the world? So, but they were there, and everything was changed. The old laws, the old customs, even in so many ways, the old language changed. So they came in and they swept everything before them, and it became a new world. Now, Bustanai, which, first of all, the name Bustanai is not a real proper name. It's seemingly a kind of a nickname. What his real name was, some think that he was called Hanina. It seems to be unlikely, because whatever we know about him was this Bustanai ben Haninai. That was his name. Now, Bustanai means, Bustan is in Persian a garden, an orchard. So he was called Bustanai because of a story connected with the garden. But this is the name that he's known for in history, in his time, and for many hundreds of years later. So this was Bustanai, the story. And now I'm saying, whether the story is, now we have very few sources, and the story is that the last king of the Persian Empire decided to destroy these rulers, the exilarchs, the Rashi Gola, to destroy all of them. And so he killed all those that he could lay hands on, which was commonplace in those times. Now we do it in different ways, but in those times it was done. And so the story is that the only one that remained of the family of David was an unborn baby. This Bustanai was then just he was not born yet. And the story goes that the king of Persia had a dream that he enters into a garden and he's with an axe and cuts off the trees, one tree after the other, and then when he comes to the last tree, an old man comes and stops him. "Don't cut this tree." And the story is that the king was unhappy about the dream. And he asked, in fact, a Jewish scholar, what is the meaning of the dream? And the Jewish scholar told him that what you saw is really the family of David. And the old man that you saw is the king David. And he urged you not to cut the tree, not to cut the last tree. So the little child was spared and was allowed to go. And this was Bustanai, who was the heir as Rosh HaGolah for the kingdom. He was in fact born into being a prince. So that is the story, and therefore this is because of the garden that the king saw, he is called the child of the garden, Bustanai. That is the story that is found in some of those sources that remained from those times. There seems to be some need to explain such a name, which is not a name. See? It is something like the garden boy, the orchard boy. See, something like this. This was the name Bustanai. Incidentally, in modern times, there are here and there children called Bustanai. Not very many. Don't know why. possibly because it's uncommon, and also because the story is not well known. Now, so Bustamante was seemingly, he grew up, and after, when he was about 16, he assumed what was called his ruler, to be a ruler. Somebody before that was somebody that was the fellow who really was his guardian. But later on he became the ruler, and then he was introduced to the king. Now, one of the things is, seemingly he had a presence. We don't know about it, but he clearly had a presence. Now, there is another story about him that we don't have real evidence about it. And there's a story that he's standing before the king as a subject, and then a fly comes and stands on just on his eye, and Bustamante didn't move. He stands without moving, with the fly bothering him, nothing. He doesn't try to drive her. And then the king asked him, why doesn't he do what naturally a person should do? And he said that he learned from his forefathers that when you are in the presence of a king, you are not allowed to move any part of your body without getting permission. So he didn't move. So the king was impressed, and they gave him, and they say that this was the sign of the Rosh HaGolah. From those times on, the seal of Rosh HaGolah had an image of a fly. So that was the image that he earned. Now, the story went on. So he was there, seemingly whatever it was. He was there. We don't know much about his doings, but possibly he tried to gather his principality, his power, his whatever it was. And then, within his times of ruling, then came the Arab invasion. The Arabs invaded Iran, first Iraq, which was under Iranian rule. They invaded it and conquered it, and then they invaded Iran, and at the end they conquered completely the country. The Sultan, or the Khalif, of the really Khalif of those times, was the Sultan Omar. Even though, just as a correction, it is the mosque that is called the mosque on the Temple Mountain, that is called after the name of Omar, is not his. Even though they tried to move it back as backwards to those times, seemingly the rebuilder of the mosque was a few hundred years later, another Omar. Even if you go in the old city, you will see the street that is near the David Citadel. It's called Umar ibn Khattab Street. That is the name, because he was clearly, again, the head of the army that conquered Eretz Israel. So he was one of the great conquerors of the world. And so he came also, he went on, and again, his armies, really devastated almost everything that was in there, including the Persian Empire. It was an empire. It was strong enough to withstand. It was always in fights with Rome or with Byzantium later. But it was they were never completely conquered. Sometimes they were the conquerors. And so they kept more or less the country, the land, and everything else as their realm, which was possibly included Mesopotamia, Iraq of our times, and Iran, and some of the countries beyond it, which is now Central Asia. So almost to the borders of India. Depended on the times, but it was a great kingdom. And this kingdom was conquered by the Arabs. conquered by the Arabs with the Arab rule, and this king Umar, I mean, he was the ruler, even though he wasn't officially, he was called Khalif, which means the replacement of Muhammad. That's the meaning of the title, replacement of Muhammad. But at least he was the ruler of the whole vast country and the army and everything in it. And then there was a meeting that he had with the Jews. It was the first time in which the Arabs encountered a big Jewish population. They had some Jews in Arabia. They tried to drive them out. They did as they're apt to do, and they sometimes mention it. They made all kinds of treaties and contracts with the Jews, but they really, really didn't keep any of them. See, when they had enough power, they drove out or killed the Jews that they could. So Arabia was, in a certain way, most of it was clean of Jews. Now in Iraq and Mesopotamia and Iran was a big Jewish population. We don't know the numbers, but there were surely hundreds of thousands of Jews. It wasn't easy to get rid of them. And more than that, it seems that the Jews had enough of the Persian rule. And Mussolini himself would just escape being killed by the ruler. And so they didn't trust the Persians. So when the Arabs came, the Jews collaborated. The Jews collaborated with the Arabs. And so it was important politically, important militarily, that they came. Certain things like this happened in other places, possibly in Spain as well, and in North Africa as well. But basically, it was the Jews collaborated, and the new Khalif, who is now the ruler of the whole country, meets Mustafa. Now, this we don't know again details of the meeting, but see, as I am saying, historically speaking, politically speaking, see, it's a new realm, it's a new government. They could destroy everything. They didn't do it too much because they were inexperienced, so they had to rely on the social and military and political structure that was before them. But still, it was something new, and they could do whatever they wanted with the position of the Jews. It was really, the Jews were an autonomy. Autonomy, an autonomy that wasn't always so malleable, so easy to rule. They had before that one or two big revolts of Jewish leaders, including one of the Rashi Gola. I didn't talk about them, but they in fact created a little Jewish kingdom in Persia. So they were strong enough to do so, and so. So the Jews were some kind of a power. And Umar decided first that he keeps the status quo. The Jews keep their autonomy, which under the Muslim law and other, but basically they keep their autonomy. They keep the Rosh HaGola as their prince, as their leader, and now we don't know details about it. We know one thing, which is that is one of the facts. It seems that Mustafa, as I say, even from his first meeting with the Persian king, but at least this meeting that is a fact with the Arab overruler, it seems to be that he was an extraordinary person. See, I mean that captivated the people that met him. So not only the Khalif granted him the rule, but did something very unusual. It seems that the last Persian king had We are not sure about it, whether it was two daughters that remained after him, or two granddaughters. Again, princesses of the royal house of Persia. And so, King the Caliph Umar took one of them as a wife, which is, you know, she could be what, I don't know how she looked like, I mean, no description about it, but I suppose she couldn't be terribly ugly, but more than that, see, it's also a political matter that the king, the new king, takes the daughter of the old ruler. So it is a feeling, it's a continuation of the rule. It's not a break. It's not a complete revolution. Now, this was one daughter. The second daughter he gave to Bustanai. So Bustanai was given the other princess, the other Persian princess, as a wife. So we have here, incidentally, you can see what I call the unusual feat. See, it is surely not a part of the work of the Caliph to do so, to find a wife for Bustanai. There is a story which I don't think it can be held that Bustanai was unmarried at that time. I don't think that they cared very much, as Muslims, as his people from the East, whether he's married or not married. But he gave him the other daughter, which means he becomes, in some way, he's the Caliph's brother-in-law, which is, you see, it is a very unusual situation. Unusual because see, here you have this Jewish ruler is becoming not just that he's tolerated, but he's given a very high person. It's not an official position to be the king's brother-in-law, but it's a very practical, very, very high position. So in that sense, you see, the fact that Bustanai was there and the fact that Bustanai married this daughter meant not only, it meant that the whole system will continue. And so it was. For many hundreds of years, it continued. The Rosh HaGola, under the Muslim rulers, and they changed from one house to another house, from blood dynasty, but still, the exilar, the Jewish ruler, was still the prince of the Jews, and, as I say, a very high official in his time. Now, as I'm saying, when I speak about this in a historical view, it means not only that the old system continued, but the old system was in a way enhanced and enforced by that. It's a big change because it means that the Jews got not just the official religious tolerance, but they got also a position in the state. This was created in those times, and as I say, the state changed many a time, but. But these Jewish princes remained the rulers of the Jews. The relationship with the kings were not always even, but still they were the rulers of the Jews. So historically speaking, it is the man Bustanai is not just a person that was just standing between two periods. Bustanai was the person that really made it possible to continue the whole system. To continue the rule of the house of David, to continue the system of the Jewish autonomy. So all that is, as I say, even if we wouldn't know anything else about him, it just means that he's the person that kept, which in a time of real upheaval, when everything was collapsing, so this remained stable. So the Jewish prince remained in his position. The Jewish autonomy remained in its former power, and that meant for the Jews in that area. Perhaps they were basically much better off than they were under the Persian rule. But it was, a part of it was because the rulers needed them. They were collaborating with the new rulers. That is one thing. They didn't have anything else sentiment for the period rulers. That were many times they had very hard times under them for religious and other reasons. So they didn't have a sentiment. But still, you have a whole group of people, an important group of people. Some of them very rich. Some of them very important artisans, doctors, scientists of those times. That were connected to the new rule. But still, it means he did something that very few people did, which is to continue, to keep the continuation of his position, which wasn't just his personal position, but he was the position of the person who is continuing the system. The system continues with Pusternak. Now, just to add to it, which is, perhaps, I'm not sure if it's a nice story, but that story is very well documented. Pusternak married this girl, whatever she was, and they had children from her. So there were children that were, on one hand, they were Jewish princes, on the other hand, they were Persian princes. But they were the children. Now, some time passed, and then the children of Pusternak's Jewish wife came with a notion. See, that these boys or young people or their descendants, they are really not Jews. They are just simple goy. See, they have a goyish mother. The mother is a goy. She was princess, but for the Jews, that didn't really matter very much. So they are simple goyim, and as goyim, they were raised in a Jewish home. They are slaves. And they wanted to treat them as slaves. So that went, at those times, and many years later, it came into the courts of the Gaonim. Because, you see, it was on one hand a family quarrel, but on the other hand, it had, say, not only, I suppose, monetary ramifications, but also some political ramifications and others. What do you do with these children? So, the main point was, because it was those times, what was the status of this princess? And the rabbis made a decision that, because we know Pusternak, and he was a righteous person, he surely wouldn't marry a Jewish girl. So it's sure that he converted her. We don't have documents, but it's surely that he wouldn't be like this. And so it is a sure thing that she was converted. And so they ruled accordingly, and the children kept there within the family with their old position. So they were so in fact. With the times, later generations, see, the story remained alive, and the disagreement between the two parts of the family were there, and from time to time it appeared. So many years, perhaps 100 years later, when one of the Gaonim writes a letter, and he writes about the same thing. He says, we are descendants also of Rosh Hagola. And we are descendants of his Jewish wife. So he made it a point of a Jewish wife, not of a non-Jewish wife. So for many generations, it was some kind of a memory. And see, for some people it was important, because if you mention it 200 years later, it seems that it was a subject of discussion. But as we know later on, first, that some of these descendants of the Persian princes became Rashi Gola on their own, so nobody stopped them. And later on, that even some of the later time Geonim were the descendants of these princes. So in that sense, even though it was, it finished with the story. But this is a story about which we have names. We know the name of the wife. She surely had a Persian name. See, we know the name of the wife, and we know even some of the names of the descendants that were later on living there. So all in all, that was a quaint conclusion to the story. This was, in a certain way, just to tell you, it was based not on any kind of clear proof, but it was connected with the notion that Bustelnai was a righteous person. Bustelnai wouldn't do some irregularity in his own home. So if he was married to her and he has children by her, it surely everything was all right. So the trusted me enough in the later years to that everything was all right. So the story has, in that sense, I would say, perhaps it's a happy end of the story. The story of the Jewish prince and the Persian captive. See? It could be a nice material for if some of you, I don't know if any of you has any attitude or any desire. It could be a nice subject for poetry, or even for a short story. Just let's imagine the whole picture there. But going back to it, and I'm trying to more or less to summarize the thing. So you see. But I mentioned when I brought in the name of Bustelnai, this was the kind of an end of the story. His marrying of this wife and his having children and what happened during the ages. But what was important was that historically speaking, it's meant. I don't know how much, and we don't again. We don't have enough material to describe it. I'm sure that in a certain way, even this kind of a marriage had something to do also with the Persians in the country. See, because in a certain way, the descendants of Bustelnai are also the descendants of their last king. So it meant something for the people that the relationship between them and the Jews had to be, I would say, more friendly because of that. So in that, even though I'm sure that Bustelnai wouldn't dare to offer to get this girl for himself on his own, but it was a gift of the king. And you cannot say no when the king gives you a gift, especially when the gift is possibly a nice, good-looking woman. So it didn't say no. But as I'm saying again, what I try to say: here we have a person that we know. We don't know much about him. What were his other deeds? But clearly, he was the man that was there in the time of a change, in a time in which the world was shaking, not only shaking, breaking up. And he was there, and he, at least for the Jewish part, he held the continuation of the line of the princes of David. I'll come later. One of the people that I'm going to mention is possibly the last known person of this line. But it took hundreds of years until it happened. So for the time being, you have here, he was in the middle of the period, and that in that period, he was the man who consolidated the position of the Jews, the position of the ruling house, and the whole notion of the Jewish autonomy. This was very important thing because at those time there was the great yeshivot, the great center. It was the greatest center of learning, the greatest Jewish center that spread from there to all over the world. So he kept it there. So I suppose it's worthwhile to remember him as a person, as some kind of, when I mentioned the King David, it was just because it seems that the King David had also this quality, and also this politics of keeping the tie to the old ruling house, which he was very, very clear in trying to keep it. But it was also because, those people were they loved him. Now Bustanai seems to have this quality because it came to his help when he was under the Persians, but his position was unclear. It came to his help under the Arabs, which was a completely different way, and the ability to bind these things together. It means he's not well known, but we don't have many people who had the same kind of an important position in, he is standing between two walls. One is collapsing and one is being created. And he keeps, at least his part of it is kept for the next, I would say, at least more than 300 years of continuation, which is for a royal dynasty. And for the life of people, it's a very long time. So that is for in the glory of Bustanai. Okay.